will be hand over to the Rahul Kumar sir. Sir, yesterday's session we have received a good feedback. So today also I am expecting that feedback will be more. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being the part of the webinar, and you are sharing the good valuable thoughts. Thank you, sir. And the session is yours. You can carry. Yeah.
So good morning, everyone. And first of all, let me thank the audience and Satya sir for giving me some positive news that the students has liked it, and there is very positive feedback which has received. So I hope the audience will they enjoy today's session also, because I will be covering today mostly some important critical regulations which are required to be performed, and these are very mandatory tests which cannot be skipped. And apart from that, we will take up some few basic color fastness tests. So let me just share my screen. Yeah, so my screen is visible to all. Yes, Satya, my visit is.
Yeah, sir, it is visible to all.
Yeah, okay. So just to refresh what we have discussed yesterday, so we started with the importance of the testing. We discussed about the reasons and the purpose of doing the tests. And we also discussed about different type of testing, that is destructive and non-destructive type. We, in fact, I gave you the definition of the testing, and we discussed about the importance of standard test methods and standard atmospheric conditions. Apart from that, we also moved and discussed about the stages of textile testing. So this is all what we have discussed yesterday. Now going forward for today's session, I'll start with some important legal regulations. Now the question will be coming to your mind, why these are legal requirements, and also on top of it, these are mandatory requirements. So to give you the answer for these two questions that must be coming up in your minds, because everybody needs basically this safeguard. So in order to safeguard the risk to the consumer and also to the manufacturers, the government basically comes up and releases certain regulations, and it makes a mandatory to all the manufacturers that they have to go for the testing of these mandatory regulations, so that the risk to the human body and to the manufacturer or to the consumer, you can say, is minimized. So I will be covering five basic legal requirements which are required to be fulfilled. And the first one is the safety. Now, as the name suggests, it is basically related to the safety aspect. Now, when we talk about the safety, mainly two product categories has been covered into this regulation. One, if you see the digital here, one is the infant garment and one is the adult garment. Now, these two product categories has been covered into this safety regulation. The reasons are as follows. Now, in case of this infant garment, the age group for the infant wear is from 0 to 3 years. Now, if you see, there is a particular habit of the infants or small babies. So, can you answer me what is the habit of the infants? What they do all the time? When they, wearing some garments or something on their body, what is the peculiar habit of the infants? Quickly, can you answer somebody? Can anybody give me an answer for this? What is the peculiar habit of the infants or the babies? Anyone? Can anyone answer? Till now, no answer. No one is giving any answer today. Why so? Now, the simple basic answer for this is the babies have a habit of chewing everything. whatever you know comes in their hands, they put it in their mouth. Now, into looking into this kind of situation, when they are putting everything in their mouth, you know, basically, for example, there is a button on the garment, or there is some applique, or some small attachment is there on the garment. If they put it in their mouth, and unfortunately, if the button or that applique comes out from the garment, so there is a chance that it may choke their throat. So there could be a risk of choking hazard. So the safety, in order to safeguard the safety of this infant, all the baby's garments need to be tested for safety regulations. So there are some regulations in the European market. The test is called EN71 part 1, 2 and 3. Now in this part, there is one important test which is being covered is related to saliva. Because you must have noticed the continuously saliva is coming out from the mouth of the babies. So if they are putting some dyed or the fabrics in their mouth, there is a chance that that dye may be hazardous or it may be containing some carcinogenic material. So in order to safeguard or the health of the baby, the important test will be the color fastness to saliva test. So for the infant wear, color fastness to saliva test, attachment strength, and also the small part, sharp edge, sharp point, these are some important critical tests which need to be performed. So whether it is a garment or it is a soft toy or any kind of product which is meant for infant wear, the safety regulation testing is required to be performed. Likewise, if you see the second example is the adult wear. Now in this adult wear, this is a hooded jacket with the drawstrings. Now this adult category is also being taken into the safety regulations. Why so? Can anybody tell me why this drawstrings hooded jacket is being considered into the safety regulations? Any answers? Adult jacket, hooded jacket with the drawstrings is also considered into the safety regulation requirements. Why so? I think people are not giving me the today's answers. I don't know why. Okay, now let me give you the answer because I have to move on. Now, if there is a chance, you know, that drawstrings may get entrapped in any of the situation. And because of this entrapment of the drawstrings, there could be a choking hazard. Your throat may get choked. So the safety requirement for these kind of products is even the length and the strength of these drawstrings are also specified in the test method, so that the risk to the adults with respect to these kind of product categories is reduced. So this is all basically related to the safety requirements. Now I move on to the second, which is related to the fiber composition. Now a question to the audience. Again, a very simple basic question. I expect an answer for this. Have you ever noticed any kind of label which is being attached to your garments? Have you seen any labels which are attached to your garments? Yes or no? Yes. So what is the first thing which is mentioned in this kind of labels? What is the first thing which is mentioned over there in the labels? What is the first thing which is mentioned? Wash area? No. Wash note? No. Size? No. Apart from all these things, what you are mentioning is the first thing which is mentioned is the composition, the fiber composition. The basic component or the basic composition of the fabric. So if you see any label there, it is always mentioned the composition, whether it is cotton, polyester, nylon, wool, something of that sort. So it is mentioned over there. If you see the first label, it is mentioned at 100% cotton, and in the second it is a blend, it is 50% cotton and 50% polyester. Now in this regulation, it is mandatory that for all kind of products, the fiber composition is required to be disclosed and declared. Now in this case, there are two things which is important. First, we have to give the fiber name. We have to give the fiber name, whether it is cotton, polyester, nylon, or any kind of fiber. So this is the first thing which is required to be mandated and which is required to be declared. And second is the composition, means if it is single fiber, in that case you have to give it is 100% cotton or 100% wool, 100% silk, something of that sort. And if it is a combination of two or more fibers, even then we have to declare the percentage of each and every fiber. So the second important regulation is related to the fiber identification, and this regulation says that we have to declare the fiber type as well as the percentage of fibers available in the product. So there are different guidelines which are required to be followed, and there is one guideline which is applicable to most of the products, that is called FTC guidelines for US market, and this FTC stands for Federal Trade Commission. So this Federal Trade Commission basically declares the different kind of guidelines, that this is how we have to declare the composition of the product. Now, if you have seen the labels, and you were replying also to me that there are some care label instructions which are being mentioned. Labels are basically the guidelines for the consumers, that this is how the product is required to be used in actual wear condition. Like after wearing, what happens? First we have to wash it, then we have to dry it, then we have to iron it, sometimes we have to use the bleaching agent also, and then there are some products which are not suitable for washing. In that case we have to go for dry cleaning. So these are the five important and critical things which are required to be mentioned, and with this it is called the care label instructions, or care labeling is the regulation name. So the government of any country, whether it is meant for US market or the European market, Japanese market, even for Indian market, there are regulations which are required to be followed for care labeling. And then we have to give some instructions with respect to these conditions. Now, if I have to say, particularly for the US market, you have to give it in the words. You don't have to use the symbols, but it has to be mentioned in the words. But if it is, the shipment is meant for Europe, then you have a choice. You can use words as well as you can use some symbols. So for washing, this tumbler symbol is used. For bleaching, triangle is used. For drying, this square with the circle inside it is used. Ironing, the iron symbol is used. And for dry cleaning, this simple circle is used. So these are the five basic symbols which are required or used basically to give the care label instructions. So this basically completes and gives an insight to the care labeling regulation. Then we move on to the fourth important legal regulation, that is flammability testing. As you know, all textile materials, whether they are natural fibers or whether they are man-made fibers or they are regenerated fibers, every fiber has a tendency, either they burn or they melt. So for certain product categories, it is mandatory that we have to go for flammability test. Now, there are two or three product categories for which it is mandatory and you cannot skip the flammability test. First is the adult wear and children wear sleepwear. So children wear, the age group is from 0 to 14 years. Up to the 14 years, if any product is there, it is classified as is children wear. And adult wear means beyond 14 years, whatever product is there, it is coming into the adult category. So for these two product categories, whether it is children wear or it is the adult wear, the sleep wear has been covered into the flammability test. Now my question to you, why only the sleep wear products are being used for the flammability test. What actually happens when we sleep? Can anybody answer me? Can anybody answer me quickly in the chat box? What happens when we sleep? What happens when we sleep? Quickly, any answers? No. When we sleep, what happens at that situation? Are you able to sense something? Maybe, no. The answers which you people are giving are not correct. Actually, what happens when we sleep? Or even the children, basically their sensing power is less. You know, what happens if we are sleeping? We are not able to identify if some fire situation is arising. We cannot even sense it. So the children wear products and the adult sleepwear is being considered as a risky items and is being covered in the flammability regulations. So all children related products and adult sleepwear categories are mandatory to be tested for flammability tests. Now the second product category which is being covered and mandatory for the flammability test are the floor coverings. Why floor coverings are also taken into this category? Can anybody answer me? Can anybody answer me why the floor coverings? Why the floor coverings? Why it is being taken as a risky product, a product category, and is mandatory for the flammability test? The floor coverings, bath mats, carpets, all these kind of products. See, if you are lighting a cigarette or maybe you are lighting a matchstick, there is a chance that it may fall down. When it is going to fall down, your first product which is going to catch fire is your rugs and carpets or the floor coverings. So for that reason, in order to safeguard and minimize the risk to the human body and to the assets, we have to go for the mandatory flame test for the rugs and carpets. And then upholstery. Upholstery means all your sofa items or the furniture items. These are also basically taken into the mandatory flammability regulations. So this was the fourth regulation which is related to the flammability test. Then last regulation, which is again a very important and critical one, is the chemical testing or the eco testing. See, as you know, there are n number of dyes and chemicals and different type of products which are being used in the manufacturing of the products and which may be harmful to the human body and also to the environment. So if anything which is harmful to the human body and to the environment, it is being considered as a risk. Now, in order to minimize the risk to both of these, that is your human body and to the environment, we have to go for some chemical tests. And also different countries follow different regulations with some different names. For example, in US market, there is one regulation which is called CPSIA or CPSC. Then CPSC means the Children Product Safety Commission, that is one regulation. Then the other regulation which is there in the European market, that is it, the regulation name is REACH, R-E-A-C-H, R-E-A-C-H. This is the European regulation which is mandatory for the European market. If you see some digitals here, I have shown you some green products. Green products means after doing the chemical test, we can classify whether your products are safe to use or they are safe products, means they are not harmful to the human body and also to the nature or to the environment. So there are n number of tests which are being covered into this chemical test. There are some different regulations, and in regulation itself, there are different clauses which are required to be mandatory followed. So for this, at this moment, for you to understand, you just simply understand that there are some mandatory chemical tests which are required to be performed in order to minimize the risk to the human body and to the environment. And then there are some important regulations. If you see, I mentioned about the REACH, R-E-A-C-H. This is for European. And then CPSC, that is for for US market. So these are the five important regulations which are required to be mandatory. And again, I repeat that these regulations, regulatory testing must be followed. You cannot ship your goods unless and until these five regulatory tests are being followed or tested on your products. Now, for you people to understand the different categories of the test, I have listed out some common tests into three categories. One, the performance related, because this is what I have taken the names yesterday when we were discussing about the stages of the testing with respect to the fabric and the garment testing. I was taking three names: the performance related, durability related, and the regulatory related. So for you people to understand, I have listed out some tests in the performance related. So in the performance, the first category is the color fastness test. And the five important color fastness tests are washing, rubbing, water, perspiration, and light. There are n number of other class color fastness tests also, but that all depends on the end use of the product. Then the shrinkage or the dimensional stability is also one important test which is required to be performed. And this is also come into the category of performance related test. Then spirality. Now a question to you. Have you ever heard this name spirality? What is this spirality? What is this spirality? Have you ever noticed in the knitted garments some spirality? What is this spirality or spiral nature? What is this spirality? Quickly, anybody answer? Anybody want to give an answer? Flexible, no. Spirality means, what does it mean? No shrinkage, no. No, you. Curling, yes, Deepika is perfectly, you know, your answer is correct. So, of knitted garments, at the lower sides, you know, at the lower ends, on the side side, twisting is there, some curling is there. So this is called at the spirality. And then pilling. Pilling is also one of the tests which comes in the performance related. So these are some important basic performance related tests. Now coming on to the durability test. Durability are basically related to the strength test. The tensile strength, tear strength, busting strength, and seam slippage. These are all durability tests. And abrasion can also be covered into the durability test. This can also be covered in durability, as well as abrasion can be considered into a performance related also. Now coming on to the some regulatory tests. So regulatory tests, I already have listed out: fiber composition, care label, flammability, safety test, and chemical test. Now in this chemical test, there are some names of the tests: pH, formaldehyde, azo dyes, chlorophenols, phthalates, inorganic tests. Some metallic tests are also covered. Why metallic tests are covered? Because there may be some metallic items which are attached to a garment. What are those metallic items? Zippers or your snap buttons or some metallic buttons which are used on your garments. They may contain lead, cadmium, nickel. So for that reason, metallic tests are also covered into the chemical tests. Then I mentioned about the regulations. Different markets, different regulations. US market, CPSC, European market, REACH. If you want to note it down, the name of the REACH, full name of this REACH, I speak it out. R stands for registration. If somebody want to make a note of it, please note it down. R stands for registration. E stands for evaluation, A stands for authorization, and then CH stands for chemicals. Means registration, evaluation, and authorization of chemicals. This regulation was came up in the market in the year almost 2005 and 2006, and this contains basically two clauses. One related to the RSTS testing or the restricted substances testing, means pH, formaldehyde, azo, and some inorganic tests. And the second clause basically covers some chemicals which are called SVHC. Note it down, please. SVHC. S stands for substances, V stands for very, H stands for high, and C stands for concern. SVHC, substances of very high concern. These are also some chemicals which are listed out by this body who has released this regulation called REACH. When this regulation was floated down in 2005 and 2006, there was almost 31 chemical parameters which were covered, and as of now the list has increased to almost 196 or 200 chemicals. So now you can see every year there are some revisions and are coming up in the market, and the list is increasing. So for that reason, it is important for you people to understand that these are the regulations which are being followed in different countries, so that you are not in a you don't get a surprise when you are able to, you are shipping your goods and the testing is complete in all respects. So now we move on to the quiz one. Audience, please come in the chat box. Now some basic small questions for you. Why regulations are mandatory to follow? Answers, please. Why regulations are important to be followed? Answers, please, quickly. I will not move on to the next question unless and until I get a reply for it. Customer service, no. To avoid the hazards, or you can say to minimize the risk to the human body and to the environment, right? So regulations are mandatory basically to minimize the risk to the human body and to the environment. Now, second question, why flammability test is mandatory for sleepwear? I gave you the reply also. Why sleepwear is being taken as a mandatory test in the flammability? Low sensing power, yes. Then hoodies with the drawstrings must pass safety test, yes or no? Yes, yes. Mohit Mehta, Honey Nair, yes. Everybody is giving me the correct answer, yes. We have to, the hoodies with the drawstrings must pass the safety test. Now give any two durability tests. List out any two durability. I gave you some examples for the durability test. What are those durability tests? Tensile, Deepika, very right. What else? Other second test. Tensile test is one. Shrinkage is not. Tensile, second. No. Strength for seam strength, Deepika. Yes, again, you are right. So, tensile strength, seam strength, busting strength, seam strength. These are all durability tests. All strength-related parameters are covered in the durability test. Now, coming on to the examples for the performance test. Quickly answer this. Performance test. Yes, color fastness test is one. What else? Deepika, washing rubbing is one color fastness test. What else? Second. Washing is covered. Rubbing is also covered. Dimensional stability, Deepika, that is shrinkage test. Okay. So, shrinkage and color fastness test, these could be the two examples for the performance test. So, now let's move on to the next topic of this today's discussion, that is the color fastness. What is color fastness? What do you understand by color fastness? Answers, and can anybody want to answer it? What is color fastness? What is color fastness? Its answer is there in its name itself. What is color fastness? Can you give me an answer for it? What is color fastness? Color fastness is how much fast your color is. Or Vishak, yes, very right. Color resistant. How much resistant your color is. That is color fastness. So we can define color fastness as it is resistance to change of color. Means how fast your color is basically is defined as color fastness. Now, this color fastness depends on certain parameters. Now, the first important parameter is the selection of dye. Then, the dyeing process. Then, third is dyeing procedure. And then, some after treatments. So, these are four important parameters on which the color fastness properties depend. The selection of dyes, dyeing process, then dyeing parameters, and the after treatments. So these are some important parameters on which the color fastness properties actually depend. So now we move on to the first color fastness test, that is color fastness to rubbing. So if you see this digital, you know, white fabric is being rubbed over the dyed or the printed fabric. So there is some staining happening on the white fabric, right? So means by simple rubbing action or having some friction or rubbing the fabric with the friction on the surface of the other fabric, we observe that the transfer of color from one fabric to another fabric. So this property is called color fastness to rubbing. And again, I repeat, this is the most common test which is required to be performed, that is the color fastness to rubbing. Because whenever we wear any kind of product, and for example, we are wearing a pant and then we are sitting on a sofa which is having some upholstery, right? So when we sit, sometimes, you know, there is some friction happening. Now, because of this friction, there is a chance that there may be some staining or transfer of color from your pants onto the upholstery material. So there is some rubbing action happening. Because of that, there may be some staining or transfer of color from one fabric to the another fabric. But why does it happen? Now the question is, why does this happen? So if somebody want to answer this, what is the reason for this poor color fastness test? Can anybody want to answer? Poor dye. Rahila, no dye ability. Yeah, no. Not exactly poor dye or the dye ability. The reason is improper after treatment. Light means, for example, you have completed the dyeing process, but you have not done enough after treatment to remove the unfixed dye from the surface of the fabric. So what will happen? The unfixed dye, which is not being permanently absorbed by the fabric, it remains on the surface. Now, because of this unfixed dye, which is available on the surface, there is a chance of having poor rubbing fastness. So this can be avoided by doing some proper after treatments. Now, to assess this color fastness to rubbing, we need to have this croc meter. And then there are these two test methods which are commonly used, ATCC8, ATCC116, 165, and ISO methods are there. And then we have to use some white poplin cloth, which is called as the croc cloth. We need to have some distilled water also, blotting paper also, and then gray scales and the matching cabinet. I'll let you know for what reason these gray scales and matching cabinet. We will come when we will do some assessment. But for this moment, just think over it that you have to perform the color fastness to rubbing test. So this is the croc meter. This is the croc meter. And this is the weight, this is the rubbing peg, this is the finger, then rubbing area is there, and then this is the clamp basically to hold the fabric. Now, how this test is performed? The sample is mounted, the white poplin fabric is mounted on this finger, the finger is basically put down on the fabric. We run this finger on the top of this fabric for almost 10 revolutions. After this, this white fabric is removed from the finger, and then it is assessed for staining, that how much color is being transferred from the surface of the fabric onto the white poplin fabric. So assessment, we will take it up later, but at this stage, we have to do the assessment for staining. How much dye is being transferred from one surface to the white poplin fabric or the croc cloth. Now, coming on to the color fastness to washing test. Now, what happens when we do or when we wash our clothes at home? Now, there are two situations, right? Now, the situation one and the situation two. Now, in situation one, what happens? We mix all different type of garments, whatever available at home. They may be fabrics, they may be garments. We collect all these products, put it in the washing machine, irrespective whether they are cotton, polyester, nylon, acetate, something, you know, we forget about all those things. We just mix all together, put it in the washing machine, and then we add some detergent and then start the this cycle, and then we wash our clothes. Now in this condition, what is happening? We have taken the water, we have added some detergent, and since there are different type of fabrics and the garments, there is some abrasive action happening. And what happens because of this abrasive action, because of this detergent, there is a chance that some of the fabrics may lose their color and they may stain other garments. Now, in order to assess both of these properties, first, color change, and second, staining on different fibers, and then we have to perform this test in the laboratories. Now, in order to conduct this kind, or in order to simulate this kind of situation, in the labs, what we do? We use this machine, which is called laundrometer, right? So first we take a laundrometer, then we take a sample, but if in this case it is a red color sample, we attach a multifiber. Now what this multifiber is, now for you people, this is the multifiber strip. Now in this multifiber strip, if you see, there are six different fibers: wool, acrylic, polyester, nylon, cotton, and acetate. Now my question to the audience, why only these six fibers are taken? Quickly, we are running short of time, otherwise I have to, you know, take the other slides very quickly. So I need answers very fast from you people so that I move on quickly. Because very right, Deepika, absolutely correct answer. These are the most commonly fibers which are used in order to manufacture or make the garments or the products. Wool, acrylic, polyester, nylon, and cotton, and acetate. Acetate is the fiber or the material which is being used as a lining in the blazers or the coats or the suits. You have, might have seen a very shiny material, and also these are used for making the ladies' garments. So these are the six common fibers which are there in the multifiber strip. So what we do, we take a sample of the product which is required to be tested. We attach a multifiber strip. Now in the laundrometer, these are stainless steel cylinders. So we open this steel cylinder, we put the sample, take some water, add some detergent, and then we add some steel balls. Now why these steel balls are added? Can anybody want to answer it? Why these steel balls are added? Why these steel balls are added in the jars or the stainless steel cylinders when we perform this test in the lab? Yes, very right. Vishak, absolutely perfect to give the abrasive action. So what we take? We take this cylinder, put the sample, add water, add detergent, put some stainless steel balls, and then close the lid and run the machine as per the cycle. After that, we take out the sample, rinse it, and do the assessment. And for this assessment is required to be done for two things. Now, what are these two things? First, color change, and second, staining. Now, we have come to the stage of assessment. Now, before this assessment, let me take the other situation in continuation to the washing. What is that situation is? See, many times, the first situation is when we were washing our clothes with the detergent. Now after that, what happens? We take the fresh water, rinse it, but after that there is a chance that we leave the washed clothes in the stationary condition inside the machine for some time. We leave the garments there as it is without even drying those products. So this also happens a lot in our households. And sometimes, if not in the washing machine, we take out the garments, put it on the floor, or put it in the baskets. So what happens in this situation? There is no detergent, there is no movement happening, but even then there is a chance of transfer of color from one fabric to the other fabric, and also there is a chance that the other products may get stained. So this particular color fastness test is called color fastness to water. The first one, we were we used detergent and we moved used the abrasion cycle, that is called color fastness to washing. But in this case, it is a stationary test, no detergent, stationary condition, but this test is called color fastness to water, right? Now, for you people, it's very important to understand the results for color fastness to washing and results for color fastness to water. They cannot be compared because the conditions are entirely different, entirely different. Now, color fastness to washing test, how we have to perform in the labs, that I already have discussed with you people. Now, how this color fastness to water is to be tested in the labs, for that we use these kind of perspirometers. These perspirometers contain some glass plates or some acrylic plates. So what we do, we take the sample, attach a multifiber strip to it, take the distilled water, dip the sample along with the multifiber strip properly into it so that it absorbs the water, and then we sandwich that sample between these acrylic plates, and then we apply some weight. Why this weight is applied? Because when our garments were lying in the stationary condition in the buckets or in the washing machine, there was some weight of water which was falling on the garments. So in order to simulate that kind of situation, we have to put some weights here. Now this weights, as per the standard test methods, we have to put the weights here, and then this perspirometer is required to be kept in this oven. And then we have to maintain a temperature of 37 degrees centigrade. 37 degrees centigrade, the test specify, and time duration is being specified again in the standard test methods, whether it is ATCC method or it is ISO method. They specify for how much time we have to put under this condition, so that all after the testing is done, again we have to do the assessment for two conditions. First, the color change, and second, staining on different multifibers. So we move on to the assessment part. Now we take the gray scales. So there are two type of gray scales. One is for color change and second for staining. So, and the grades are given from 1 to 5. 1 is the severe change and 5 is the no change. When there is no change in the color, we give the grade 5. If it is slight change, we give 4. If it is noticeable change is there, we give 3. And if it is a considerable change, then we give grade. But there is a chance that something may lie between 3 or 4 or 2 or 3 or 1 or 2 or 4 to 5. In that situation, we give it as a 3.4, 3.5. or 4.5, 2.5, or sometimes in the European standards, we mention it as 2 to 3, 3 to 4, or 4 to 5. But if it is in the for the US market, we mention it 2.5, 3.5, or 4.5. So this is how the grades are required to be given for color fastness to washing test, color fastness to water test. And then interpretation is to be done for to both of the things. Color change as well as staining. Now for assessment, we use these kind of matching cabinets. These matching cabinets has different sources of lights. Now the different sources of lights could be daylight, could be fluorescent light or cool white, ultraviolet light. So there are different sources of light under which we have to view our samples. And then there is a platform which is 45 degree angle inclined. So what we do, we take the tested sample, we take the original fabric sample, and then with the help of these gray scales, we assess it. And then we give the numerical grades from 1 to 5. So this is how the grading is or the assessment is done. Now, very important thing to mention here, and these matching cabinets, they are basically painted gray in color from the inside. Now my question to you, why only gray is selected? Why only gray color is selected? Any specific reason for it to select the gray color? Anybody want to answer this? Come in the chat box. Why only gray color is selected? in the matching cabinet when we do the assessment or the interpretation of test results. Any answer, any for color, Nitya, for this is what I'm asking, that why gray color is this matching cabinet is painted gray in color, uniform color, no, accuracy, no. Gray color is considered to be a neutral color. Gray is considered to be a neutral color. For that reason, these matching cabinets are painted gray in color from the inside so that it does not affect the assessment when we do or the interpretation of results. So this is the reason the gray color is selected. So now we move on to the next color fastness test, that is color fastness to perspiration. Now what is perspiration? Very simple question. What is perspiration? What is perspiration? Or the sweat. Sweat, perspiration is the sweat. Yeah. So, and sweating is a very natural phenomena, and we all perspire when we wear some garments because of the humid atmosphere or because of the high temperatures. We all perspire. Now this perspiration, it can be either acidic in nature or alkaline in nature. So what do you understand with respect to acidic or alkaline? What is the pH of acidic? Or what is neutral pH? What is neutral pH? From the scale 1 to 14, what is new? Yes, Anjana, very right. 7 is the neutral pH. Now, in case of acidic, what is the range for acidic? Acidic, 1 to 6, Mohit, correct. Yes, Deepika, below 7, right. And what is alkaline or basic? More than 7, yeah. So, more than 7 is your basicity, and below 7 is acidity. So our perspiration or the human perspiration can be either acidic or alkaline in nature. What happens, you know, you might have noticed also when you are wearing some garments, maybe your top, gents wearing some shirts, particularly in the armpit areas. If you see these armpit areas, we all perspire and we notice that sometimes there is color change. We notice that there is some color change, and this color change is because of the property of the dye, right? And secondly, what happens, the inner wear, particularly if it is white in color, they get stained also. So how we have to do the assessment for color fastness to perspiration? Again, in two conditions, for color change as well as staining. So for color fastness to perspiration, it is important. Color fast. I gave you an example yesterday also, that for as per the end use of the fabric, particularly for the ladies' tops and for the garments where we have going to have the perspiration, or the gent shirts, the color fastness to perspiration test is a mandatory test, which should not be skipped. The reason is because of this sweat. So what will happen? We have to do the testing in the labs. Now, in order to simulate these kind of condition in the lab, the original sweat solution is not available. So we have to make some artificial sweat solution of acidic nature as well as alkaline nature. Again, it's different test methods specify that what kind of pH perspiration is required to be tested for ISO methods and ATCC methods. And since the human body temperature is close to 38 degrees centigrade, the testing is also done at 37 to 38 degrees centigrade. Again, same way, perspirometer, multifiber strip, drying oven, and then pH meter. pH meter basically to check the pH of the sweat solution which we are going to make in the labs. And after that, the same way, we take the Petri dish, put the sweat, artificial sweat solution, take the original sample attached with the multifiber strip, put it in the Petri dish, properly absorb it with the artificial sweat solution, sandwich those between the acrylic plates, put it in the perspirometer, and then this perspirometer will be kept in the ovens again at 38 degrees centigrade, again for the time as per mentioned in the standard test method. After that, the assessment will again be done in the matching cabinets using two type of grayscales for color change and the staining on different fibers, and accordingly the grades will be given from 1 to 5, right? So we move on to the last color fastness test, that is light. Why this color fastness to light test is important? Tell me, and how, where do you find this? Why it is important for color fastness to light? Or what you observe when your products are dried in the sun? What basically you find? What property you get it when your fab fades? Deepika, absolutely perfect, right answer. So we observe the color change, and this color change is defined as fading. So in order to assess the fading property, we have to test the materials in the and the test is called color fastness to light test. Now for this light test, we have to use the different type of instruments in the labs, which are called, either they are called water cooled machines or they are called air cooled machines. The lamp in both kind of these machines which are nowadays used, the lamp which is used are called xenon arc. The lamp is called xenon arc, X-E-N-O-N, xenon arc. Okay, so this lamp name is xenon arc lamp. Xenon arc lamp, right? So this is the lamp which is used, and then I was talking to you with respect to what happened. No? Yeah, so the machines which are used are called water cooled machines and the air cooled machines. Now, since we have to run the machine continuously for some 15 hours, 20 hours, 40 hours, depending on the type of the material being tested for color fastness to light test, so there will be some heat generation. So in order to cool down the lamp, we have to use some mediums. So one medium is cool air. The machines which use the medium cool air, these machines are called air cooled machines. Whereas if the cooling medium is ultra pure cool water, in that case, those machines are called water cooled machines. The water cooled machines are basically used for ATCC methods, whereas the air cooled machines are used for European market. And in this color fastness to light test, the grades are normally given from 1 to 8 for European standards and 1 to 5 for American standards. So these are basically the difference between the American methods and the European methods. American methods, they go for water cooled machines. European, they go for air cooled machines. Grading is 1 to 5 in American market, 1 to 8 in the European market. And then lamp is common in both the cases. So these are the major basic differences between these two test methods. And finally, we do the assessment again in the matching cabinet using the grayscales. And grayscale will be used for American standards for color fastness to light assessment. Whereas for European methods, we have to use these blue standards. And these blue standards are coming from grade 1 to grade 8. So that is the reason we have to do the assessment from 1 to 8. So for you at this moment, just to understand that what is the major differences between the American standards and the European standards, you just make a note of it. I again repeat, American machines, first water cooled machines, xenon arc, then your the assessment is from 1 to 5 and the gray scales are used. Whereas the European markets, air cooled machines are used, xenon arc, and we use blue standards, blue wool standards, and the grades are given from 1 to 8. So these are the major differences. So with this, I close today's presentation. But before that, some quiz. Very quickly, we are running short of time. So I need an answer very quickly from you people. Now the first question is, what is color fastness? Again, the definition of color fastness. Quickly answer this. What is color fastness? Answers, please, quickly. Not fading. resistance of the color is the right answer. That the resistance of the color to the color change is the color fastness. Now, are color fastness to washing and color fastness to water results will be the same? Yes or no? Washing and water results will be different. It will be different. They will not be same because the conditions are entirely different. Now, for men's shirts, color fastness to perspiration is an important test. Yes or no? Yes, Deepika, right. Absolutely. Urajan also correct. Yes, because we observe perspiration particularly in the armpit area. So, for that reason, for any kind of product categories where we observe the perspiration happening, maybe your active wear, sports wear, ladies tops, or your yoga wear, where we observe these, the sweating is happening, we have to go for color fastness to perspiration test. Now, why garments are normally suggested to dry undershade? Why? Why do not want to? Yes, to avoid fading. Absolutely. So that the direct sunlight does not fall on the wet fabric, so that the fading property is there. So avoid this. Avoid fading. We always recommend that they should be dried under shade. Then the last question is, what are the grades used to interpret the color fastness test? Again, interpretation. How many grades? One to gray scales, two type of gray scales for color change and staining, and the grades are given from 1 to 5. 1 is the severest change and 5 is the no change. 1 to 8 is given only for color fastness to light test, that too only for European market. So with this, I say a big thank you to all of you. Before closing my PPT, let me, if somebody want to click the pictures of the slides that I have shared in these two sessions, I quickly run over the slides. You can just take the screenshots, right? You can take the screenshots very quickly, right? So slide number 1, slide number 2, then slide number 3. You can take the screenshots quickly. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. And then from today's presentation, right? First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28. So that was the last one, right? So with this, I conclude my PPT for today. So what else, Satya? Any questions? Satya, can you hear me?
Yeah, sir, I can hear you, sir. Yeah. Participants,
any questions?
If you have any doubts from these two sessions, from the yesterday session and today's session, if you have any doubts, you can ask him. You can drop your questions in the chat box. So someone asked about the full form of CPSC.
This is Children Production Safety Commission. Children Product Safety Commission. You can Google it out also. You can find it. Then super. Sindhu is saying super explanations. Thank you, Sindhu. Thank you today. Okay. Any other question? Audience, name of the chemical which help to set colors in the fabric. Means you want to say, Rahila, I think you want to say that which can make the colors fast, you mean to say. This is what you want to answer question. Your question is, see, there is no single chemical as such, you know. There is no as such chemical which is applicable to all kind of classes of dye. But yes, the different classes of dye basically recommend different type of after treatments. For example, if it is dyed with the direct dyes. As you all know, the direct dyes have very poor color fastness properties, but we have to increase the for this enhancement in order to make them more fast. What we can do? We can do some after treatments. And these after treatments basically increase the molecular size of the dye molecules by which they do not easily come out. So this is how it is recommended for the direct dyes. But in the case of reactive dyes and in the case of wet dyes, they themselves have very good fastness properties. But they only recommend that we have to do very stringent washing so that all the dye materials or the dyes which are on the surface of the fabric are easily removed off. Means unfixed dye should be removed, completely removed. So this is how we can make it, fast. Now there is question from Deepika. Are chemicals used for children garments? Deepika, yes. The chemicals are used, but then there are some green chemicals also available nowadays. Even there are some azo-free dyes are also available, which do not contain any kind of harmful chemicals. So particularly for the children garments, since the beginning, you know, for the manufacturing stage, we have to use those kind of chemicals to safeguard the children. Right? Is that clear, Deepika? Okay. Any more questions? We already have surpassed the time. So it's almost
there is some questions in question and answer box.
Okay, no problem. Let's take those questions also.
Okay, Anisha has asked that will all the textile material will undergo all type of testing?
See, Anusuya, if you remember, yesterday I told you the selection of the testing parameters depend on some factors. In that, the first thing was the end use. Now, whether it is polyester, nylon, cotton, wools, any kind of material. But yes, the testing is to be done. The reasons, first the regulatory test, then performance related test and the durability test. And then the selection of the test will depend on particularly the end use, then the country of destination, the market segment. So on those different type of factors, we have to select the test parameters. But yes, all kind of textile materials, they have to go for testing. Then the second question from Anjana. Can you please explain what opportunities of home science? I think she is basically asking me some different kind of question, not related to the PPTs what that we have given. I think she is asking about the job opportunities, right, Anjana? This is what your question is. But will all the text this already I have replied. Can nylon be dyed with solvent dyes for making MB? What does it mean, MB? And anonymous attendees, we don't answer your questions. You have to write your name here, otherwise we will not answer this. Next, move on to the next. Sanjay R. Biochemicals are used in dyeing. Biochemicals basically related, I think what I understood from your question is related to enzymes. Yes, enzymes are used. Enzymes are used. Any more questions? Yeah, I think that is done. That is done. Now let me see the chat box also if something is there. So I think who are the person testing these methods for textile materials? The testing labs are there, Deepika. I can name some testing labs. SGS is one, ITS is one, Bureau Veritas is one, then TUV SUD is one, then UL laboratory is there. So there are n number of testing labs which are available now in India. These are all multinational labs. Then Gopal Krishnan, is testing variants for normal organic or BT cotton? Yes, the test methods will be different for all these kind of materials. Yes, it will be different. Any more questions? I think I have replied to all the questions. Right, Satya? Satya, I think I am done. So
yeah, sir, you have done. You have done.
So can you take the feedback from the people now?
Yeah, okay, sir. You just share, you tell about the last slide also, sir. To the
last slide I have given, no?
Yeah, you have given, you just explain. Not an issue. Last slide means the contact details.
Yeah, the contact details, no? Yes. So, for any kind of seminars and webinars, or if you want any kind of workshop to be taken on textiles or the management topics, so you can contact me. So, my email ID is rahulkumargarg30@gmail.com. And then my contact number is 93548-76766. So these are my contact details. From my side, I thank you all. Thanks, Satya, once again for organizing two wonderful sessions. I really enjoyed sharing my knowledge with these students. And the audience was also very supportive. And they have, they have given me a patient listening. Whatever I want answers I wanted from them, they have very quickly replied also. So from my bottom of the heart, I really want to thank the audience and to you. Thanks once again to everyone.
Sir, I really want to thank you. Participants, I have posted the feedback link in the chat box. You just go through the chat box. And you will have a link. Just follow that link and post the answers. Is Ramya Bharati is in the... Ramya Bharati?
Yes, sir.
Sir, I welcome Ms. Ramya Bharati, student of Costume Design and Fashion, AJK College, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I thank you, Mr. Rahul Kumar, sir, for a wonderful session. We learned many things. I thank our college secretary, principal, and my staff for arranging this workshop. Thank you all for being a part of this successful webinar. Thank you all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And again, the pandemic season is still on. So again, a piece of advice from my side. Please wear mask, maintain the social distancing, and take care of yourself and your family. Thanks once again. With this, I take a leave and say goodbye. Thank you.